I request Professor Abdul Mateen to deliver his keynote address, sir.
Professor Wahab, President for this inaugural function and Registrar of Maulana Azad National Urdu University, Shri Sinhaji, Director General, National Institute of Rural Development, Hyderabad, Dr. Alok, Professor Shri Vastava, distinguished delegates, professors, academicians, officers, and all the members of Maulana Azad National Urdu University, Mr. K.M. Ziauddin, the coordinator of this seminar, one-day seminar. Ladies and gentlemen, good morning to everyone. The seminar topic is Childhood Poverty in the Context of Social Exclusion, organized by Center for the Study of Social Exclusion and Inclusive Policy, MANUU, in collaboration with Young Lives India. I'm extremely grateful to Professor Wahab for consenting to preside this function in a short time, because initially Professor Janab Kyar Iqbal Ahmed Sahab, Vice Chancellor in charge of Maulana Azad National Urdu University, was supposed to preside this function, but then he had to rush to Delhi for an urgent work from Kerala, and he sent regrets and also the best wishes for the success of this seminar. I'm extremely grateful to Shri Sinhaji for gracing this occasion in spite of his extremely busy schedule. Words are inadequate, and distinguished delegates present in this hall for making this program successful. May I start with my personal experience of 1985, when I was a student at the University of Toronto, Canada, and there was a lecture by a professor, and the message of that lecture was that bureaucracy has failed in providing the services, and hope against hope lies in the civil society. I was really delighted to listen the similar kind of voice, not other than a bureaucrat himself who has served for over three decades as such. No wonder the kind of work, the kind of data generated by NGOs like Young Lives ideally should have been more exclusively by research institutes or universities like Maulana Azad National University. But then, with the dedication and commitment, some of the NGOs are pioneering. They deserve kind of congratulations for data generation, and now time for dissemination of these information at its preliminary stage as such. May I draw attention of this august audience regarding the magnitude of child population in India? And according to an estimation, in 2000, we had about 361 million children, which happens to be about 36% of the total population. In the world, in that time, we had 6 1,055 million over 6 billion population. And out of that, we had 1,658 million child population, which happened to be 27% of the world or global population. Even by 2015, when this Young Lives Project will come to an end, we will have about, and according to an estimation, 372 million children under 15 years of age, which will be 30% of the total population of India. So the point is that this is quite a substantial number. If you look at simply the number or the percentage of the share of child population to the total population as such. And therefore, in this background, I would like to draw the kind attention towards few interesting, thought-provoking findings of the Young Lives Project India. I am struck by some of the findings of Young Lives, like urban children who are better off in terms of material goods have lower subjective well-being than rural children. Parental education, even when household resources are controlled for, has a positive impact on child subjective well-being. Children from scheduled castes, from large families, or from households where casual labor is the primary occupation report lower aspirations for their future. Household material resources are not the only determinant of subjective well-being. Interestingly, this finding, in along with other findings of Young Lives, are also can be supplemented with the observations Shri Sinhaji just now has made on the basis of the empirical situations of the Asian tigers or Southeast Asian countries as such. The other finding of Young Lives, that is, household and community characteristics greatly influence children's outcomes, particularly ethnicity, the rural-urban divide, which affect access to services, among other things, and parents' level of education. Household wealth is an important determinant of the child outcomes. Interestingly, material education has a stronger impact on nutrition, while the father's education is a more important determinant of enrollment. I do not wish to go into the details, because after the inaugural session, we'll have in-depth and detailed discussion on these issues, the tentative findings and analysis of Young Lives project. But the point, what can we learn from these findings? Is it that this will be, the data which have been generated by Young Lives will be put in some library and then it will be left untouched or merely be used for research purpose? I think there is a difference in this project, unlike other projects or other research works. One of the objectives of this project is also to disseminate information and impacting the policy as such. And it is here, on the issue of inclusive policy, which is feasible through a variety of ways, including, and again, Professor Shri Sinhaji has already referred, well, I said by mistake professor, he deserves to be a professor anyway. Social movements, pressure groups, civil society, and dissemination of information having implications for public policy. These are some of the ways to impact the policies of our country. I'm happy that the policy and communications work of the project has been listening to what children have to say about their lives, their aspirations and opinions about the future. Participatory activities for the children to create ideas which can be compared and combined with young lives' other findings. In this way, the project has provided opportunities for children to express their views on poverty and influence policy through the Young Lives Policy and Communications work. As far as public policy impact on children is concerned, I understand that the project has related with the agrarian crisis, examining the drought leading towards entering into credit, credit leading towards debt trap or indebtedness. These are some of the interesting findings of the project which needs attention of the social scientists for impacting in the policy formulation. The point which I would like to draw attention of this august audience and the participants for today's seminar is regarding conceptualization and contextualization. I represent a center which is Center for the Study of Social Exclusion and Inclusive Policy, and we have certain duties to discharge as it is expected by University Grants Commission. And as the head of the center, I would like to look upon social exclusion as a multidimensional and dynamic process. It refers to the social relations and organizational barriers that block the attainment of livelihoods, human development, and equal citizenship. It can create or sustain poverty and inequality, and can restrict social participation. As a dynamic process, social exclusion is governed by social and political relations and access to organizations and institutional sites of power. Reasons for social exclusion may be caste, faith or religion, language, ethnicity, natural disaster, famines, droughts, floods, tsunami, etc. And increased vulnerability due to globalization, exploitative relations of production, etc. May I draw the attention of this august audience towards one of my favorite contemporary sociologists, Manuel Castells, who has defined social exclusion as the process by which certain individuals and groups are systematically excluded, are systematically barred from access to positions that would enable them to an autonomous livelihood with the social standards framed by institutions and values in a given context. According to Castells, this process is taking place worldwide. Diverse categories of people in many different countries are being excluded and pushed to the side. What is new and different about this is the fact that this type of social exclusion is the diversity of its victims. It is this diversity and global reach that he captures under the label the fourth world. In his magnum opus entitled The Information Age, Economy, Society and Culture, third volume, first published by Blackwell in the year 1988, and reprinted three times the same year and revised and updated in 1999, one full chapter revolves around the rise of the fourth world, informational capitalism, poverty, and social exclusion. Castells has observed that a new world, the fourth world, has emerged, made up of the multiple black holes of social exclusion throughout the planet. The fourth world comprises large areas of the globe, such as much of the sub-Saharan Africa and impoverished rural areas of Latin America and Asia, but it is also present in literally every country and every city in this new geography of social exclusion. It is formed of American inner city ghettos, Spanish enclaves of mass youth unemployment, French banlieues warehousing North Africans, Japanese Joseba quarters, and Asian megacities, shanty towns. And it is populated by millions of homeless, incarcerated, prostituted, criminalized, brutalized, stigmatized, sick, and illiterate persons. They are the majority in some areas, the minority in others, and a tiny minority in a few privileged contexts. But everywhere, they are growing in number and increasing in visibility as the selective triage of informational capitalism and the political breakdown of the welfare state intensify social exclusion. In the current historical context, the rise of the fourth world is inseparable from the rise of informational global capitalism. As far as social exclusion in India is concerned, it may be examined covering many dimensions in the areas of resources, both material and non-material, participation and quality of life as a complex and multidimensional concept. In this background, may I draw attention of academicians, activists, administrators, and policymakers towards 66 million Muslims living in rural India today, and their magnitude and intensification of marginalization. Social exclusion of Muslims in land ownership in contemporary rural India can be easily comprehended by taking historical background into consideration. Ayn-e-Akbari is the testimony that only Ashrafs or high-caste Muslims had access to land. This can be buttressed by Athar Ali's meticulous investigation on association between caste and substantial land owners constituting as elites in the Mughal India. Azlafs and Arzals had a subordinated position in the hegemonic structure, which continued during the British Raj. After all, majority of them were converts from low-caste Hindus, a social fact which requires social scientists serious and rigorous research probe. It is no wonder why Gini coefficient, a measure to quantify land ownership inequality, was quite high and closer to the value 1 in some parts of India, where zamindari system was introduced by the introduction of the permanent settlement of 1793. Ironically, Muslims in the lower stratum of the peasantry, marginal and small farmers, in access to land ownership in rural India did not substantially change even after 6 decades of zamindari abolition in India. Access to land is not merely the source for subsistence for a substantial number of farmers in rural India today, but it is also a source of prestige and power. Even after 6 decades of independence, exclusion due to marginalization, persecution of people on account of social, religious, caste, and gender are adversely affecting the developmental outcomes. One must rigorously examine exclusion from access to land in spite of many land reforms programs, caste-based exclusion, gender-based exclusion, exclusion of the old and infirm, exclusion of widows, and exclusion of the physically handicapped among STs, SCs, and OBCs in general, and Muslims in particular, and its association with childhood poverty in India in general, and Andhra Pradesh in particular. May I also draw attention of the august audience that something fundamentally went wrong with the Mahanobisian model of planning. And I would also like to draw attention of Michael Lipton, the author of Why Poor People Stay Poor, that uneven resource allocation. Majority of the population lives in rural areas, and majority of the resources are allocated in the for the urban areas, and imbalancing the two. That needs rectification. That rectification demands civil society's participation. For participation, we need well-informed data. In this background, finally, I would like to conclude with a request to Young Lives for a future collaboration with our center, CESIP, on the issues implied in my observations. Can we look upon child poverty in terms of Ashraf, Ajlaf, and Atraf categories among faith-based communities in India in general and rural India in particular? In the light of the Satcher Committee report, let this seminar be a beginning in this venture for future collaborations with Young Lives. Thank you.